إن الحمد لله
نحمده
ونستعينه ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من هداه الله هو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له من دون الله وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله صلى الله وسلم عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد Brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh.
The issue at hand is that of the family planning. What are we going to say about it? Initially, we should know that as far as the Sharia of Islam is concerned, family planning is not something that Muslims are to advocate for. Rather, they should consider it haram. You cannot plan your family. But what you can do is to create a space between the delivery of a child and another. Therefore, the one that is acceptable is child spacing. That is the language that Muslims should be using. We should not be using the term family planning, because Allah is the one who plans everything for you, as it will be very clear from the lecture, inshallah. Initially, we should all know that there is that prohibition of child mother, M-U-R-D-E-R. Before birth or after birth. The killing of the child, the mother of the child, is prohibited before birth or after birth. I will go with you to two verses from Al-Quran Karim. The first one is from Surah Al-An'am, Quran chapter 6. In verse 151, Allah says there, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ. لَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ. Do not kill your children due to poverty. Due to poverty. Don't kill them because of poverty. Make them laugh. Because of poverty. Then in another Quranic verse 31 from Surah Al-Isra, which is chapter 17, Allah says there, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ. Do not kill your child for fear of poverty. This one is because you are fearing poverty, you kill them, you eliminate them. Now, what is the difference between the two? Killing them because of poverty means that after birth, you eliminate, because you undergo poverty. You experience poverty, so you eliminate them. The other one, to kill the child for fear of poverty, that one may occur before birth, when abortion is administered on the woman, you don't want that child to come because you fear poverty. So that is the simple difference between the two positions. One is done because of the fear of poverty. Another one is done because there is already poverty prevailing. That is one. Number two, people of the world have been applying different methods of family planning before the emergence of the Sharia of Islam. In the African continent here, they used to kill a child deliberately so that the little thing they have, according to their own thinking, will be enough to cater for the rest. That is their own thinking then. And that is why in the Yoruba land, they will tell you, Shebi ni onon to do a bi ibeji, tonpa mbe, to the benuma, ti o seri mo ibe ibeji ni iti o shebi. Meaning that a twin came into existence and then one of them is eliminated. And the person who witnesses it will never tell anybody. With that, people will not know that this particular baby is a twin. They will never think about twins, about his delivery. They will be thinking that he alone got one. They used to do this. Not only that, sometimes they used to sell. They used to sell children and get money to cater for the remaining children with them. But that one is not killing. Except that it is the killing of the biological lineage. Because by doing so, that child will now belong to another family instead of the biological parent. In the Arabian Peninsula, in the pre-Islamic era of ignorance, the method that they used to do is that if a woman is pregnant and it was revealed to the soothsayer, fortune teller, that the embryo is a girl, they will be looking for a way of eliminating that baby girl. And in an instance where the baby refused to go but come to the world, they will still go and bury her alive. And that is what you recite in Surah Takwir. In Surah Takwir, where in your mental says in verse 8 of this chapter 81, where that mu'udat su'ilat, you should always remember when on the judgment day the girl buried alive will question the parent Why has she been killed? For what reason? Because when she herself will be asked, why you did not grow up before departing the world, she will never turn the question to the parents. They will immediately want to answer. That is why you have the expression, Waida Lumudato Sukilat. When the girl buried alive will be asked, what has been your error? What has been your sin? What has been your offense that you are not allowed to grow up? So she will now direct the question to the parent, because they are the one accountable for her elimination. As I told you, even before birth, they used to discuss having girl children. For what reason? In that pre-Islamic era, when a girl will be ripe for marriage, many men would be entering upon her. When she will now become pregnant and after delivery, the soothsayer or the one who follows the steps of lineage will tell them who the father is among those different men. And so, those among the Arabs of that period who do not partake in that practice, therefore, hate to have baby girls. And that is why Al-Bari Kareem now told them in Surah Al-Nahl, Quran chapter 16, in verse 59, أَيُمْسِكُ عَلَىٰ رَهُونِمْ. Will he now try to keep that pregnancy, even the disgrace that he's expecting, that maybe when this girl will come and when she grow up, she will not marry decently. You see, the same person who will go together with other men to touch one woman will not like him to be done to her side. Or he will allow the embryo to come out and then come to go and bury the child in the soil. If you follow up the way Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have tried to suppress the bad practices of the Jahiliyyah, the Islamic era, you will be surprised. One man went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, I am very interested in your religion, but something is preventing me from embracing it. And he said, what is that? He said, your religion does not allow adultery, and I cannot keep my body away because I have money to spend, and there are women who want people to spend on them and then sell their bodies. But your religion prohibits this. That is what is preventing me. The Prophet said, what do you mean? Come closer to me. You are talking another big ruler. Don't come closer to me. We have something to say together. He said, you have money. I said, how do you say I have money? I was not bad. have children? He said, yes, I have children. Boys and girls. Okay. You the only child of your parents? No, I have siblings. I have women among my siblings. They are both siblings now asking, will it please you that that same thing is done to your mother, your wife, your daughter, or your sister? I said, no, no, in our family, we have good training for members of our family. They will say, it's like that. No man will ever like that to happen to his side. That was how the man regained his common sense and he repent and embraced Islam. See the way you can help us also. Pushed him without violence. Without violence at all. Now, the issue is family planning, and we have mentioned some ways people used to plan their family members so that they will not be having much children based on one reason or another. Now, if family planning is not allowed, which one is allowed, or in what way can man survive not being put into difficulty for not having fun with his wife? And also, in what way can the woman survive by not having her husband distancing himself from her? Because a married lady will find it very, very difficult to remain without the man coming to her. It is a great punishment for her. And that is why one of the measures laid down the Sharia to checkmate a disobedient wife is to boycott her bed. When you boycott her bed, that one will serve better than flogging. Am I communicating? That one will even serve better than flogging. When you boycott her bed by not having a fear with her, she will quickly repent. She will quickly adjust if it has been written for her to repent. Because I say this because there are some ladies who are very, very stubborn. I even have one case at hand now. I have a case at hand that the man has been boycotting that lady for the past 6 months. And the lady is not adjusting. And we have everything together normally. Everything together normally. But he does not sleep with her on the same bed. And he does not allow her to come and join him on his own bed. But as for feeding, everything continues normally. Even paying the school fees of the children is going on normally. Even catering for some expenses she asked for, everything is going normally. But he has been avoiding her on bed. But up till now, that lady was not adjusted. She continues to say, I am not the one suffering. You are the one suffering. Because you know that I have already entered menopause. That is true. So no menstruation anymore. No, there are some women like that. And when a lady knows the area of your weakness, you will be in trouble. If a lady knows the area of your weakness, it is from there she will be shooking. Mira Metala enabled us to have a peaceful matrimonial affair. Family planning is not allowed, but time spacing is allowed. How can you now make time spacing? According to Sharia. The Sharia of Islam permitted the coitus interruptus. The Sharia of Islam permitted the coitus interruptus. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam permitted the Sahaba radiyallahu anhu to practice al-azm. That one is known as al-azm in Arabic. Ayn zayu lam azm. That is coitus interruptus. He allowed them in the 60 year after Hijrah, when they went to a battle. The name of the battle was the Battle of Mustalah, Bani Mustalah. God's word, Bani Mustalah. As Imam Bukhari recorded the hadith, on the authority of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, in number 7409, it is Sahih. And the Masabu Sabaya, that from that battle, the Sahaba, together with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had some female captives of war. And in fact, one of the wives, later wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was one of those captives. Who knows her name? That is Duwaira. Duwaira, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was one of those captives of war. So she fell into the portion of the Prophet, so the Prophet liberated her and then married her. Am I communicating? So the Sahaba, who had portions from those captives of war that were females, فَأَرَادُ أَنْ يَسْتَمْتِعُوا بِهِنَّ وَلَا يَحْمِلْنَا, had interest in enjoying intercourse with them without them becoming pregnant. فَسَأَلُوا النَّبِيَّ صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الْعَزْلِ. So they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the practice of coitus interruptus with those ladies. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered them saying, "Ma alaykum alla taf'alu, ma alaykum alla taf'alu." There be no blame if at all you don't do. Which means that it is better for you not to practice it, but at the same time, no blame if you don't practice it. You are free. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ كَتَبَ مَنْ هُوَ خَادِثٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Because Almighty Allah had already written and preordained all of those he will create till the resurrection day. If you interrupt your organ and make your drops outside the hole, that will not prevent a pregnancy that has been needed. Because sometimes you will decide to withdraw when you have already started ejaculating without knowing. So with that, you will not be able to prevent what had been preordained by the mental to occur. A man who must sleep in his own hadith on the authority of the same Abu Sa'id in number 1438, also recorded. ذكر العزل عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم that coitus interruptus was mentioned in the presence of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. People were asking him about it. But also he said, وَلِمَ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ أَحَدُهُ Why should one of you go into that? Because when you withdraw, the woman suffers. She will always complain. Why are you withdrawing? Except if she is the one expecting children. Am I communicating? A lady who is looking for children and know that a child can be created is different from the one who is no more having interest in the child bearing. If you withdraw from that one that has not yet entered into menopause, she will always complain because it is harming her somehow. She will not be enjoying. She will not be enjoying. But the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, وَلَمْ يَكُنْ فَلَا يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ أَحَدٌ will not say that none of you should ever do that. You should not withdraw. You should not be practicing coitus interruptus. فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَتْ نَفْسٌ مَخَلُوقَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهُ خَالِقُهَا Because there would never be a soul predetermined by Almighty Allah to be created except that Allah will create that soul. Whether you like it or not. Inasmuch as the two organs meet, anything can happen. We have the story of a lady whose husband started practicing coitus interruptus because they have had so many children. They had 15. And we now say that that should be enough for us. So let us just stop that. We are to stop. But unfortunately for them, when they practice that coitus interruptus for 1, 2, 3 years, in the 5th year, the woman started complaining stomach pains. They thought it to be something ordinary. When she went to the hospital, they did test for her, and they said she's pregnant. They were surprised. With all that they were practicing, it occurs like that. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not say that men should not do it, but he said, why do you need to do it? What calls for it? What calls for it? Especially when the lady is still in need of children. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani mentioned an hadith number 1023 in Bulugh al-Muram. You all know that Bulugh al-Muram. At least 1023, which has been recorded by non-Muslim in number 1442. On the authority of Judama, a lady, Bint Wahab al-Asadiyya, and the Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qala fi al-Dina, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, talked, he spoke, he commented about having fun with a breastfeeding lady. When a lady is still suckling a child, and you know, the suckling, according to Sharia, if to be complete, will continue to how many years? 2 years. So, having fun with her while she is breastfeeding may be affecting the child somehow, but not 100%. The affection is not 100%. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about it, ذَلِكَ الْوَعَدُ الْخَفِيِّ. But that one is a hidden bearing alive, which means it's a hidden mother. It's not clear one. It's not a clear one. Just because when a lady is breastfeeding and she becomes pregnant again, the milk after certain period may not be flowing as expected. And when it will not be flowing, what will happen to the infant that is sucking? There will be a problem. There will be a problem for that child. There is a problem. Don't forget that there are some women who get pregnant within 6 months after the delivery of their child. There are some women like that within 6 months, even before some of them. Some of them like that. A lady, I have experience of many ladies who have become pregnant within 3 months. Even among my own children, my first marriage, there are some who were born just a little month after a year, the first time. So it occurs like that. So the professor is not saying here that having fun while the lady is breastfeeding may be affecting the child. That is why we call them a wadu hafiz. They are hidden very alive. It is not prohibited, it is not forbidden, but here, as if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is advising. He is indirectly advising the couple to practice coitus interruptus. Indirectly. Now, in a hadith agreed upon by both Imams Bukhari and Muslim, on the authority of Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, "Kunna na'azilu." We used to practice coitus interruptus. Al-Ahdi Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. During the era of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is why the Prophet was still alive. Wal-Qur'an yanzil, and Al-Qur'an al-Karim was still being revealed, being communicated to the Prophet of Allah, and there was no prohibition of it. وَلَوْ كَانَ شَيْءٌ يُنْهَى عَنْهُ. If the practice of coitus interruptus is something that should be banned, لَنَهَانَ عَنْهُ الْقُرْآنَ, Al-Qur'an al-Karim would have prohibited us from Which means that the practice of coitus interruptus is not halal. It is not halal. But in our own days, apart from coitus interruptus, you know that there are many methods of contraception people are applying. The use of condom, there is a condom for the man and for the woman. The use of the lube for the woman only. The use of pills by the woman only, except that they have also introduced medicine that men can also be using. Also is the use of injection. The lady will be injected. Now, all these methods, we all know that the condom does not always prevent pregnancy, because it can burst anytime. It can burst anytime. And many couples have complained to their medical doctors that they have been using condoms, but even with the use of condoms, they had many issues. Many children with the use of condoms, which means that condom is not paying well. The loop is for the lady. It is something that they will insert into her private part. But it sometimes leads to bleeding. In most cases, it leads to bleeding. That the lady will start menstruating, and then she will be having what is known in the thinking as the hard bleeding, non-stopping menstruation. And that is why lube is not also a very good option. Pills. Many ladies are using pills. But the observation that has been noticed is that pills are weakening the body, always causing headache, and also incurable pain in the stomach. Pills cause it. Which means that this one is not also the best option.
It's not Islamic.
Now?
It's not the best option.
Yes, it's not the best option.
It's Islamic or medically.
Medically, not Islamically. It is allowed in Islam. Because if a lady, for example, if a lady goes to Hajj, she can use pill to delay our menstruation. Understand? So if that can be used, so pills is also allowed to be used to delay pregnancy. It's not forbidden. But because of the implications, that is why we say it is not the best option. Now, injections. It is very, very disheartening that in Africa, the Europeans and Americans introduced injection to us, and many ladies adopted injections, and it is causing obesity, making ladies to become fat. And if USA could complain of obesity, what then do you think about we Muslims? in our own countries. The taking of injections is not forbidden, but also is not advisable. It's not advisable. Because we have observed how it